Servus YouTube, Chef hier, back at it again, this time with the update on the turret build for the patch 1.0.11. First of all, shoutouts to my fellow Wilson content creators Steph the Dude and Cyrus Jork. They inspired me to duplicate turrets. I've never played around with this system until now. And yeah, it works very well with the turret skill since it has a short cooldown and the duration is very long. They also don't share the turret limit, they only share the cooldown, which makes this the perfect skill for duplication. With that said, I haven't found any other uses for duplicating skills so far, but more testing to be done in the future. This build is probably the most tanky out of all that I've done so far, since we are using a shield. However, this means that we need a Saracel affix on either weapon or shield, which is not too hard to get, but it's not easy either. You could also use a catalyst to avoid crafting altogether, or you could use a two-handed weapon for even more damage. But yeah, with the introduction out of the way, let's go over the details in the passives, skills, items, and attribute sections. Passives. This is the finalized tree. Keep in mind that you can turn the wheels on the left side, so please align the rings like I have them. From the middle to the south, in the first ring we have the Sentinel, second ring is Warmonger and the Ranger, and in the third ring we got Siegebreaker and Alastor. There are a lot of passive nodes doing something completely different than stated, and there are a few ones not working at all. If you haven't watched my advanced guide, I recommend watching that one first, but I will go over the ones we are using in this build briefly. First of all, let's talk about the defensive nodes. We are using Salvatory Anchor and the Siegebreaker to double our flat all resistance score from chest and helmet, which combos with secure parry from disallying vessel, giving us 100% increased all res. I'm also picking up Feast for the Crass, a life leech, since my weapon currently doesn't have any percent life leech on it. Feel free to drop that one if your weapon has it though. Then we are taking Dire Juncture and the Time Weaver to not get one shot, making it so we only take 40 and 60% from a hit at a time. And then let's go over the offensive nodes. As mentioned, there are a lot of nodes not doing what is phrased on them. First example is Virtuous Stance in the Arms Meister class. This states double damage on basic attacks, however this works on any damage dealt. Also important is that we always want the Probing Weakness stance active. You can change stances by dodge rolling, so either never dodge roll or always dodge twice in a row. Next up we have Residual Energy in the Warlock tree. Another node with false phrasing, this is additional damage scaling with our total attack damage. Keep in mind that only spells that actually deal damage can trigger this. Next we have Immortal Offering in the Kabbalist tree. It is currently the most powerful node in the tree and probably will get nerfed in the future. And again, inaccurate phrasing on this, it gives additional damage for every stack of a different ailment up to 5. We combo that with Grievous Afflictions to apply more ailments and Sacred Oath in the Praetorian to apply weakness every time we block. Then we have Beacon for the Lost in the EOS. And yet again, this is additional damage, not increased damage. This node is the reason why we want at least one gear piece with Force Shield on it, since it wouldn't work if we didn't have any at all. Next up we grab Witch Time, cannot heal. This node cannot crit, so it's not as good as you would think, but it is still around 25% additional damage. Then we got the usual suspect, Frenzied Blows, and the Child of Fury doubling our attack damage well above 750 reach. This also has false phrasing, this only works with attack skills, not spells. Since with the unique Wield Eclipse you could make spells use Rage, but it doesn't have any effect. And then the other passive points are spent on crit damage, since it scales all of our additional damage even higher. 40% crit damage in the Soldier, 60% in the Assassins with Merciless Lethality, 10% in the Praetorian, 20% crit damage in the Siegebreaker down here. And lastly, 20% in the white arrow between acute tracking. This does not really matter since generic damage increases to almost nothing. We get 60% damage increased from here. Perspectively, we already gain 800% increased damage from attributes alone. So this doesn't have much effect, and that is also the reason why we only focus on additional damage in the passive tree, since it is around 20 times as potent as generic damage increases. And then the last 10 points are optional. We don't have any other good notes to get. I personally get Blessed Silver and the Exorcist, giving us 50% increased projectile damage. As mentioned, this does almost nothing, so feel free to grab something else. If you lack gear with block chance and block efficiency, you could grab more instead of these points and the Arms Maester. 6% block chance and block efficiency here, and the Praetorian as well, and in the Siegebreaker. You could also go for all resistance in the Praetorian if you need. Or another option for damage is Undertaker in the Plaguebringer. This is additional damage increasing our clear speed. I will now go over which points to take first when leveling. First we grab all the crit damage, crit chance and the soldier going down into the assassins. Then turning the wheels to grab the Siegebreaker. For Salvatory Anchor, giving us more defense. Now we can turn the wheels back, grabbing the points as we level up. Coming through here, we grab the Feast for the Crows for Life Leech. Then we get another defense note, Dire Juncture. Then we start finishing off getting the damage notes, which Time Cannot Heal and the Time Weaver. Beacon for the Lost and the EOS. Grievous Affliction in the Cabalist and also Immortal Offering. Going down into the Warlock, grabbing Maximum Rage here and Residual Energy. And Frenzied Blows. Then we grab Virtuous Stance, Arms Maester, Sacred Oath for Immortal Offering. This is where we have the highest damage spike. Now we just finish off with crit damage. With Merciless Lethality, then also crit damage in the White Arrow and crit damage in the Siegebreaker. We also get the All Resistance. And then the last few points as mentioned are optional. I'm personally going for Blessed Silver. In the Exorcist, we could also get some health regeneration rate and crit damage in the Praetorian. Also, the all-resistance score increases here in the Praetorian are very good. If you lack block chance and block efficiency, there is more in the Praetorian here. Also in the Arms Maester and in the Siegebreaker. And as an honorable mention, Undertaker and the Plaguebringer is also extremely good, giving us additional toxic damage. And the Green Globes can also stack. But yeah, that is it for the passive section. Skills. Our main damage skill is Avenger Auto Turret, duplicated 3 times with the same modifiers. To duplicate skills, you first have to unlock the option in the Buildings tab with the Enact Laboratory. Then you will get the option to duplicate skills at Demetra. The first duplication, the first skill, has to be at least level 10, otherwise you cannot duplicate the skill. Then the next duplication needs to be level 40 to be able to duplicate it. The most important modifiers that we are using are Twin Repeater and Ballistic Reinforcements. Those give us the highest damage, then Sleepless Sentry and Automated Ammunition for also increased uptime. And the last modifiers are optional. You could go with Autonomous Sensors to not worry about aiming the turrets. Or you could take Cardinal Focus and Unstable Engine for higher damage, but then you need to position your turrets correctly. Then we are using Flight of Gavarnir to buff our damage with Inspiring Throw. Then we buff our movement speed with drums and some reach gain with Howl of Battle. Our movement skill is Aether Jump with Time Devourers to remove the cooldown. Also triggering residual energy with Spirits of the Void, giving us additional ether damage to apply stasis. Other options for this spells that we have are Annihilation, Anomaly, Infinity Blades, and Lightbringer. So if you happen to roll any of those Sarasol affixes, feel free to use those. The last skill we are using is Mark of Impurity. We are not using the Trial Belt since it's more damage if we apply it ourselves, because the flat damage we get from a normal belt is more important. The modifiers are Guilt by Association, Fate of the Unholy, Accursed Blade, and Target Eliminated. If you don't like the macro and Wolf with that and much rather use the Trial Belt, then use these modifiers and then instead of Mark of Impurity, use Wings of Ishmir to buff your damage even further. That's it with the skill section. Let's move into items. Items. First of all, I want to talk about all the different options that we have gearing wise. Since this build is very versatile, we can get the Sarasol affix able to cast a spell on either a dagger, pistol, or shield, preferably with Aether Jump, Anomaly, Infinity Blades, or Lightbringer, since these spells would give us additional Aether damage. However, if we have enough flat Aether damage to attacks, we could make any spell work. Keep in mind though that we are getting additional damage from Beacon for the Lost, Immortal Offering, and Residual Energy, so quite a few calculations would need to be done there. The next option we have is Willed Eclipse. It allows us to cast a Shadow Spell. And the third option we have is using a Catalyst. This is the easiest out of all the three options, especially when leveling. You can always get a Catalyst, so if you take this route, drop all the block chance and efficiency for all resistance score. Now with the options out of the way, let's talk about the stats we are looking for. These stats are used in any variation of the build and they are listed from highest to least important. Main hand. We can either use a dagger or a pistol to cast our attack skills. Then we are looking for flat material damage on attacks twice, then a percent material damage. After that, percent critical damage, percent life leech, and then after that with percent critical hit chance or either the Sarasol affix. If you need more information on how to get Sarasol affixes, please refer to my advanced guide. I go over that in that one. Offhand, we are using a shield. Most important stat on here is block efficiency, because it scales multiplicative with the base from the shield. Meaning if we get 10% increased block efficiency and the base on our shield is 40%, then we effectively would get 4% block efficiency. The hard cap on efficiency is 75%, so we should aim for that. This should be very easy to get since we have a ton of defensive gem slots, 1 gems in the gem section. Then after that we're looking for block chance, percent damage increases, and other attributes or the Sarasol affix. Accessories. On rings, we are looking for the Sarasol affix, residual energy, attacks gain damage from the last spell cast. Then on amulet and belt, we want the Sarasol affix +1 to pierce. Then on the stance, we're looking for all of them 3 times flat damage added to attacks. Then percent critical damage, percent material, and then if you cannot get the Sarasol affix, percent rent or toxic is a good one to get. Armor. We want everything to be in the heavy category for the all resistance score. That is especially important for chest and helmet to combo it with our passive node. Including the pants, we are looking for a cooldown reduction on here. Then for shoulders and gloves, we want a rage cost reduction. And on the pants, we are looking for a percent movement speed increase. Then the stats on all of them from most important to least important: flat all res, percent all res, flat ferocity or toughness, percent damage, and percent health regeneration rate. Health regeneration rate is especially important because our life leech ticks only apply once we get a health regeneration tick, which helps us with survivability. Gems. We want offensive tier 1 with rubies in them for the damage, then support tier 3 with amethysts to get the transfer time reduction. And then in defensive slots, we want tier 1 with Alexandrites in them until we reach 100% block chance. After that, we want defensive tier 2 with also Alexandrites to get the block efficiency. And then if we still have room, we could use defensive tier 3 with also Alexandrites to get the all resistance score. Attributes. If you're running level 187 expeditions, I recommend enough toughness to reach at least 40k health. On anything lower than 170, I usually go full ferocity, since our high block efficiency and all resistance is enough damage mitigation that even 20k health is enough. Now that you know how the build functions, let's do a quick run. We are doing level 187 expeditions. I usually prefer doing level 160 though, since it's faster. Like I said, at that level I like to go for 40k health, and when doing lower level runs I could invest everything into damage. Because if we put all of our points into ferocity, we would get a way much more damage increase, because putting all the points into your primary attribute gives you 0.5% increased damage per point. And our secondary toughness would only give us 0.4. But yeah, it's all about the damage increase we get from it. We don't even care about the critical hit chance score, because we've done the math on all those scores in my advanced guide, and we know that after 3000 critical hit chance score, it starts to fall off super hard anyways. Also, the all resistance score is falling off at around 20k. If you haven't seen my advanced guide, there's also a hard cap on all resistance at 29,500 resistance score. You don't get any damage mitigation whatsoever. But yeah, as you can see, we're getting hit quite often from this boss here, and we don't even notice it because of all the damage mitigation that we get from our all resistance and our block efficiency. We can pretty much tank everything. I'm actually quite a huge fan of this build. It got the damage, it got mobility, and it also has quite a lot of defense. But yeah, let's fast forward to the boss here. I think this was a 4-minute run, I'm not sure anymore, but yeah, it got decent clear speed and it is really super fun to play. Here at the boss then, we stand still to try and trigger Disallying Vessel, giving us more all resistance score and also a little bit more damage. Casting Aether Jump in between to trigger residual energy and also to get our rage back. And yeah, as you can see, it's smooth sailing from here. Just face tanking the entire fight and putting down our turrets. But yeah, that's it for me. I hope you enjoyed this guide. And as always, this will be available on our community webpage with a written version and all the pictures for a quick and easy reference. And I'll see you in the next one. Servus, YouTube. You wanna hide, but you can't pretend forever. No, I see you do it. I can see your movement. Stop the bullshit. Stay real to it. Soon I'm going to a better place. Hoping what I left behind becomes a better place for y'all. You can lie to yourself and get lost in this torturous, so murderous, self-inclined.